Would the congregation please stand?
I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord.
We meet in the name of Jesus Christ, who died and was raised to the glory of God the Father. Grace and mercy be with you. Would you like to be seated? My name is Amanda, and I am the vicar of this church here, St. Mary Magdalene. We welcome all of you who are joining us live on the live stream, or who will be joining in with this funeral as a later date through the video link. You are very welcome here, and we know that by God's magnificent love, we are able to worship together wherever we are as we celebrate this wonderful life of Eileen. Eileen was a very dear and much treasured church family member here. Her kindness to me, right from my first day working here, 12 and a half years ago now, has sustained me through many a bleak time. Personally, she has been a great friend. Her humble service in getting up to come and join two or three of us for morning prayer during our weeks of prayer at 6:30 a.m. Was wonderful. She would come and reach out to others through hospitality, whether it was greeting or meeting or preparing hot drinks. Her smile and her laughter, as I'm sure you all know too well, was very, very invitational to people who were new here. Her gentleness, the sparkle in her eye, which she shared with all who came through the door that you've walked through today, will be so missed. Eileen was somebody who gathered people and led them to Jesus. And Eileen was indeed a very wise woman. She played the part of one of the magi in our Christmas journey presentation to all the schools in our parish, which we did every year. And she was one of the magi, I think, without failing, every single year. My most recent and most striking memory of her was the last time we did that presentation, when she sat just where you are, Newton, dressed in deep green velvet and a beautiful golden crown, sitting humbly, dressed as a king, a very wise woman, waiting to reach out to young children. And today she casts her crown before King Jesus, who raises her up to his glorious home for her in heaven. And so now we are gathered here today to remember before God our sister Eileen, to give thanks for her life, to commend her to God, who is our merciful Redeemer and Judge, to commit her body to be buried, and to comfort one another in our grief. So let us pray. God of all consolation, your son Jesus Christ was moved to tears at the grave of Lazarus, his friend. Look with compassion on your children in their loss. Give to troubled hearts the light of hope and strengthen in us the gift of faith in Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We're going to sing a great hymn of praise, the hymn, How Great Thou Art. Would you like to stand if you are able?
Brothers and sisters, it's my honor to be here this morning as the Bishop of Croydon, as the friend of Eileen, to honor her life, to celebrate, and also to send her on to her Heavenly Father, for whom her life beat as a faithful Christian. And we, every time we meet together in faith, we bring ourselves to the foot of the cross and bring all that we have been and all that we may have done or forgot to do. We bring that to the Lord. And as children of a loving Heavenly Father, let us ask his forgiveness, for he is gentle and full of compassion. God of mercy, we acknowledge that we are all sinners, We turn from the wrong that we have thought and said and done, and are mindful that we have failed of all that we have failed to do. Forgive us all that is past, and help us to live each day in the light of Christ. Amen. May God our Father forgive us our sins and bring us to the eternal joy of his kingdom, where dust and ashes have no dominion. Amen. Please do be seated. We now have the eulogy. We now have the eulogy.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
I bring greetings from the Turks and Caicos Islands, the original home of my uncle, and we are here to celebrate the life of our Aunt Eileen. I am tasked with reading the eulogy. Now, the book has a eulogy, but I was given a script that was penned by Aunt Eileen herself, and at the request of my uncle, I shall endeavor to read it. So bear with me, because it is lengthy, but if you knew her, you would know that she loved words. So Amos, I might need you to help me. Eileen Omita Walkin, My British Journey. Introduction. My name is Eileen Omita Walkin, and I am from Barbados. My positive contribution from a Black Afro-Caribbean origin to life and culture in today's Britain has been varied and integrated. I have worked to a large extent in paid employment, from the central government to unpaid voluntary work in local government and in the community. As a descendant of Black Afro-Caribbean origin, I would like to think that I have played a part in several aspects of life and culture in today's Britain. I welcome the challenges, and I try my utmost best to integrate in a positive manner. Barbados background. I was born in the beautiful island of Barbados in the Caribbean. I am the second sibling from a family of 8 children. I was brought up in a comfortable surroundings with traditional upbringing in a Christian home. Love and respect have always been advocated in the family motto. I am quite sure that my Barbadian upbringing reflects my contribution in the British society. After completing college, I was employed for 9 years in the Barbados Civil Service, working in the Department of Magistrates Courts and in the Treasury. Considering furthering my education abroad, I resigned from the civil service and came to England to study law. My parents were very supportive and financed my full-time education to enable me to achieve my ambition. I thank my parents immensely, and blessings be upon them. My first London profile. On Sunday, September 12, 1965, about 6:30 a.m., I arrived at the Heathrow Airport from New York, where I had spent a few days. The weather, rather cloudy and cool, was about 62 degrees. Mr. Harrison, a British consul representative, met me at the airport. We got a coach to Virginia Station. We then went into a black taxi, which drove us to the students' headquarters in Hanchester, Kensington. This was to be my temporary accommodation. 28 students met me in the lobby at Hanchester Crescent. We were given maps and accompanied by Mr. Harrison to have a brief tour of London. The following morning, I went off to Kensington College in St. George's Road. At 3:30 p.m. in the afternoon, I went to the British Consul in Great Portland Place to decide for my permanent accommodation. A very charming young lady, Elizabeth, about 20 years of age, in her second year at the medical school, employed by the British Consul on a part-time basis, was to accompany me to my permanent accommodation. Elizabeth and I walked from Great Portland Place to Oxford Street Underground, changing trains. We got off at Oval Station and crossed the road to bus number 133. We sat upstairs, traveling through Brixton, with my eyes feasting on the unfamiliar scenes as a Brixton Market, Lambeth Town Hall, Pratt's Department Store, Lion's Tea House, with a large circular clock outreaching from the building. I seemed to see many churches, including two churches at a corner looking at each other. These were the St. Leonard's and a Catholic church. The spires seemed to be equally tall. As we approached the Trail Hall in the Mitcham Lane, Elizabeth told me to pull the cord for a request stop opposite a Methodist church. When we got off the bus and walked about 100 yards, I said, Elizabeth, I wish I could use her Bajan accent here. Elizabeth, there is Conyers Road. We turned into the road. It was tree lined and clean. In a row, there were panoramic views of large, detached and semi-detached dark brick wall houses. I thanked Elizabeth for pointing out the various landmarks to me. I told her my first impression of London was very positive. I was excited and knew that I would love it here. We walked about 3 minutes down the road, and there was number 10 on the right side of the road. I stood on the pavement for about a minute, eyed the house up and down, then entered through the small black iron gate and softly pressed the doorbell. The door opened, and I was warmly welcomed by the friendly owners, Mr. Patrick and Mrs. Zena Westmars. This was my first permanent address in England. And after 42 years, I continue to love England. Academic and professional qualifications. As the years rolled by, I went to different colleges and universities. I acquired several qualifications. Some of these mentioned below are Higher National Certificate in Business Studies, Diploma in Marketing, Graduate of Institute of Marketing, Diploma in Economic Development, Classroom Training Assistant for Special Needs, Certificate in Special Needs, Reader's Training Religious Course, Certificate in Discipleship, Certificate in Theology, B BA in Social Science, MA in Sociology and Law, and more. I have done a research paper. She was very well read. She was very educated. Let me skip that. Fall in love and married. While I was at university, I fell in love with the handsome, genuine, decent young Christian man from the Turks and Caicos Islands. He also was at university. We were both studying marketing. Also a lecturer, Newton worked with the British Civil Service. Newton and I got married. He is the apple of my life. And we love each other daily. Now, this is her words. May we continue to be a blessing to each other. And they were until the end. Without him, I could not have had peace of mind and carry out my study, work, and unpaid voluntary work successfully. My husband supports me fully. Now retired, Newton is a full-time Christian writer with 2 published books. Paid employment. My employment in Britain was with the Crown Agents and the British Civil Service. The Crown Agents. While working with the Crown Agents in the marketing department, I dealt with people face-to-face or on the telephone and representatives dealing in overseas, East Asia. I also worked on the desk for Africa, Nepal, Brunei, Indonesia, St. Helena, and the Falkland Islands. I could not have been successful in my work if I did not comply and integrate with diverse people, not only in Britain, but from different parts of the world. The British Civil Service. Citizen Charter Unit. My employment seems to be dealing directly with the public. I worked in the Citizenship Chapter Unit. This was the legacy of Prime Minister John Major. I dealt with many correspondences, but mostly dealing with telephone queries. I had to have had a sensitive and polite approach. Very often, these clients were very emotional with whatever situation they found themselves in. I dealt with the matter in a positive, sincere manner. Parliamentary Works Office. Before I retired from the British Civil Service, the Parliamentary Works Office in Westminster was my last posting. Here, I was working again, dealing with interdepartmental issues. I had a very rewarding career in the British Civil Service. Unpaid, voluntary, and community work. Since I have retired, I seemed to be working more hours than when I was a paid employment. I must be careful that I do not take too much unpaid voluntary work and do not have some quality time for my husband and myself. Some of the unpaid voluntary work that I have done or am involved with are varied. I have been actively involved in education for many years at the Oval School in Croydon. I have attended Bromley College and completed a certificate in special needs. Also, a certificate in classroom assistant to enable me to be qualified in dealing with the children who have special needs. I continue to do practical and Oval School work and go once a week. I would go to school and work with the children, helping them with their reading and writing. It has been a great pleasure and involvement of many challenging and personal time to be helping these children who need assistance. I always try my best by making sure that I addressed the new challenge, making myself very well informed and knowledgeable on all current issues. Governor, London Education Authority. As a local authority school governor, my role was to make a positive contribution to the children's education, and I am called to account. I am responsible with other governors, schools, and established organizations for the children's welfare. As an unpaid volunteer, I spend about 6 hours each month attending meetings and working to further the school's development. I have enjoyed my role as a governor at the Broadmead School, and although the curriculum was prescribed, I provided the head teacher with support and advice, drawing on knowledge and experience. I respect the head teacher's position as professional leader of the school. As a school governor, I fully support the children by attending many activities, school plays, annual events, and similar. The homeless and drop-in at Spiral, St. Leonard's Church. Spiral at Tooting BC Gardens. As an active church member at the St. Leonard's Church and a member of the parochial church council, I was one of the original members, an unpaid volunteer, to be involved in the setting up of the Spiral Center. The center was set up as a drop-in at Christmas to see how it would go. The first Christmas was entirely staffed by unpaid volunteers using donated food and clothes. 45 people attended. I would work on a rota basis as Sundays and on Christmas bank holidays and some other holidays. The center then opened every week for a few years with a formal approach and project registered as a charity. These disadvantaged people who are homeless, drug and or alcoholic oriented, need to help find someone who will listen to them, offer them support, advice, and help them with their present issues. I get a sense of satisfaction working with these people and find it very rewarding when I spend quality time with them and they appreciate my valuable time. When the center started, they were all white clients. West Croydon Refugee Day Center. This is a drop-in for refugees and asylum seekers situated at West Croydon Baptist Church, White Horse Road. I am an unpaid volunteer for the last 8 years. I go on Tuesday mornings from about 10 a.m. until 1:30 p.m. I mainly help in the section with the distribution of dry goods food to take away. Some of these people are very disfigured from the ravages of war. Around burns, broken feet, blinded, and many emotional disabilities. Some of these people cannot speak English, and the interpreters are there to help them. I have a deep love for people of whatever nationality, color, or creed. The challenge of caring is to try and understand and to be understood. I try my utmost best to stop passing judgment on one another. The Bible confirms this in Romans 14, verse 13. Cold weather, floating shelter. This is an organization which I am an unpaid volunteer member at the West Croydon Baptist Church. This has been established for 4 years. The churches together at Croydon, which are about 10 of them from various denominations, will rotate each night to accommodate the clients. There will be a television for them to watch. There will be table games for them to play. They will be given breakfast from the following morning and a packed lunch to take away. They will go to another church the next evening and so continue from week to week. My duties are to help with the refreshments such as cakes, biscuits, and other hot drinks, but most of all, to talk and mingle with the clients and not to make them feel isolated from the volunteers. It is surprising how these people can be so grateful for small mercies. If I am coming from the library in Croydon, they would come up to me and thank me for my contribution and hoping to see me on my next rota. Very many of these people get a placement in their accommodation, and some of them you would not see again. Others would come to let us know how successful they are, getting married, having a job, and a family. At the end of the cold weather in the month of March, Christchurch would have a service where they can attend, and the testimonies are always positive. They would thank the paid staff and the volunteers. Okay, almost done. My interest in social activities. These are varied: listening to classical music, reading, lawn tennis, walking, swimming, traveling. Members of the Addiscombe Unity Club, Croydon Literary Society, Streeton Literary Society, Britain Society, Brixton Society, and Make a Difference Club, Black and Afro-Caribbean Concern. I have concluded that it is important to promote understanding in cultural diversity and racial harmony in the community. I would like to think that I have contributed in a positive manner within and among the British society. I may not be glaring media or television or pictorial sensational tabloids, but my contribution has been positive, challenging, and rewarding. I am well integrated in the society, from the paid central government employment to the unpaid voluntary local government community and church organizations. I love to write and perform contemporary and religious anthology poems and sonnets. My vision will be love one another. I have summed it all up in this sonnet below. Let us begin to share the beauty of love. Oh, what a joy it would be, vanishing ill thoughts and deeds, extremities of harshness to be obliterated, over and forgiven, forgotten, no one to be thought of as belittled, everyone with love and commitment, anger and brutality to be a thing of the past, never to be resubmitted, but gone at last. Overlook positively to the new cool for all. Through the 21st century and beyond, happiness would be the new vision. Everyone to be participating without being driven. Rowing love and laughter today and thereafter. Eileen O. Walkin, June 14th, 2007. Thank you for listening.
That was a book that should have been written. And I say it not in humor, because so often in our community, we have
unsung heroes and heroines. They beaver away and work in so many settings. They have achieved humbly so much, and we see them going hither and thither, and we just don't know how amazing they are and what they have done to help build the society that we live in today. On their shoulders we stand. And so that is a book that should have been written up. But I am thankful that we've been able to hear snippets of it today. And I hope that those who are in charge with Newton may find a way to put it together and put it online, because you can do that these days. And I think it's a story that we've heard and that others should hear also. So thank you once again for that. So I've been tasked to read something quite much shorter, but actually sums up a lot of what we have just heard. And it's a letter from the Bishop of Southwark, Bishop Christopher. And if he was in the country, he would be here today. But he's in the Holy Land, went yesterday. And when he heard of Eileen's death, he immediately wanted to write to Newton to express his sadness at her passing, because I know how proud she was of receiving his medal, the Lancelot Andrews Medal, and how proud she was that he put her name forward for the Maundy money also. He wrote, "Dear Newton, it is with much sadness that I heard of the recent death of Eileen, and I write to send my condolences. I was so grateful on so many occasions for her encouragement and support, and also for the support she gave to Bishop Rosemarie as a fellow Barbadian, for which she was always a wonderful ambassador. I know she was very proud of what she achieved in her life, and I can only begin to imagine the depth of your loss. You are very much in my prayers, and I send my heartfelt sympathy. May Eileen rest in peace, and may you and the family find comfort and strength in your loss. With my prayers and all good wishes, Bishop Christopher, the Bishop of Southwark." Ladies and gentlemen, please now do stand to sing our next hymn, "For All the Saints."
Please be seated for our readings from Scripture.
Good morning, church. Our reading is taken from Psalms 118, from 1 to the end. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endureth forever. Let Israel say, his steadfast love endureth forever. Let the house of Aaron say, his steadfast love endureth forever. Let those who fear the Lord say, his steadfast love endureth forever. Out of my distress, I called on the Lord. The Lord answered me and set me in a broad place. With the Lord on my side, I do not fear. What can mortal do to me? The Lord is on my side to help me. I shall look in triumph on those who hate me. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to put confidence in mortals. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to put confidence in princes. All nations surrounded me. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. They surrounded me on every side. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. They surrounded me like bees. They blaze like a fire of thorns. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. I was pushed hard so that I was falling, but the Lord helped me. The Lord is my strength and my might. He has become my salvation. There are glad songs of victory in the tents of the righteous. The right hand of the Lord does violently. The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord does violently. I shall not die, but I should live and recount the deeds of the Lord. The Lord has punished me severely, but he did not give me over to death. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us. We beseech you, O Lord. O Lord, we beseech you, give us success. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God, and he has given us light. Bind the festal possession with branches up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, and I will extol you. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. For your steadfast love endureth forever.
This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
I'm reading from Galatians chapter 6, verses 1 to 10. Bear one another's burdens. My friends, if anyone is detected in a transgression, you who have received the Spirit should restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness. Take care that you yourselves are not tempted. Bear one another's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. For if those who are nothing think they are something, they deceive themselves. All must test their own work, then that work, rather than their neighbor's work, will become a cause for pride, for all must carry their own loads. Those who are taught the word must share in all good things with their teacher. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked, for you reap whatever you sow. If you sow to your own flesh, you will reap corruption from the flesh. But if you sow to the Spirit, you will reap eternal life from the Spirit. So let us not grow weary in doing what is right, for we will reap at harvest time if we do not give up. So then, whenever we have an opportunity, let us work for the good of all, and especially for those of the family of faith. Thanks be to God.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Oh no, this is church. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen,
amen, amen. Amen. May it be so. That's what amen means. May it be so. Before I give the word that I've prepared, I wanted to pay tribute to Newton Walkin. Because that amazing woman, that amazing story that we heard of someone who came here. Do you know, it's not the traditional story that we hear of people who come, who live in multiple occupancy, who met the signs of no blacks, no Irish, no dogs, who struggled. And I'm not saying she never did that. But what she gave us was another story, another picture, so that we could see that there were multiple ways in which people lived their lives in this country. And the one thing she said, and I don't know how you did it, because did she ever sit down? She was like a whirling dervish. Whenever you met her, she was coming to go to do. She was on the way to and from. Can I have this picture? Have you got that piece of paper? Can I be doing this? What else can I do? And yet, alongside her, keeping her company, was her husband, who enabled her to do and to be all that God had called her to be. And as she said, she may not have, you know, been on the front page of newspapers or been the first one to be interviewed on television. But like so many saints in glory, she was a soldier of our Lord, working hard to build his kingdom. And Newton was alongside her. So we give him thanks. And we give God the glory. Amen?
Amen?
Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Friends, brothers and sisters in Christ, and all who have come to mourn Eileen's death and celebrate her life, we have heard her speak to us almost as if she were right here in this church with us. And Eileen wanted us to not only hear her story and those words spoken about her life, but she wanted us to hear God's word broken for us and spoken into our own lives. As it says in Psalm 118, and as we heard, I will not die, but live and proclaim what the Lord has done. This morning's reading comes from the final chapter of Paul's letter to the Galatians, and we hear Apostle Paul calling on the followers of Christ to bear one another's burdens. He counts on us to have courage and to do what we can for one another, especially
when we are in the midst of the valley of the shadow of death. Brothers and sisters, Paul's letter is directed at a vital question for followers of Jesus in his day. So the question was, could a Gentile, that's a non-Jewish person, who becomes a follower of Christ, was that person obliged to keep all of the Jewish laws, which included not just the Ten Commandments? We talk about the Ten Commandments and we know we don't keep them. But they had Ten Commandments and hundreds of other laws and rituals. And Paul wanted to fight the idea that they had to, when they became followers of Christ, follow all and be obliged to follow all those laws and those rituals. He himself was a former Pharisee, so he rigorously followed all of the laws. But he recognized, my friends, that the law could become a burden to some that led either to guilt or perhaps sometimes to avoidance of religion or church. The person might say, as hard as I try, I can't obey every law, so maybe I won't bother to try to obey any of them. Or it could lead, and Eileen spoke about this, it could lead to self-righteousness or pride or judgmentalism. I am far superior to you because of my scrupulous observance of the law. And Paul wanted none of that. And he also knew that following all the laws does not necessarily make a person become kind and loving. Or we might say in the family of faith, might not make them a good Christian. So Paul spends much of the letter contrasting the works of the law with faith in Christ. And he tells the Galatians that Christ frees us from the burden that the law has placed us on us. But that doesn't mean that we can do whatever we want, whatever we please. No, we're under a new obligation, Christ's law of love. In today's passage, Paul says, bear one another's burdens. And Eileen says it's one of her favorite phrases. And so fulfill the law of Christ. What he means by the law of Christ is Christ's commandment to love. And Paul says to the Galatians, for the whole law is fulfilled in one phrase, one word. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. So how do we, brothers and sisters, how do we fulfill this command to love? The first thing we must do is open ourselves to God's Spirit and allow God's Spirit to transform us. And when that happens, we radiate what Paul calls the fruit of the Spirit, which is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Paul recognized, as we must do, that there can never be enough laws to detail the precise response that each specific situation brings to bear. But if you, my brothers and sisters, exude the fruit of the Spirit, you will respond with Christ-like love. Now, some of you may be sitting here thinking, oh, that's a wonderful message for the followers of Jesus. Sorry, my friends. There are no reserved seats for those called to serve the common good. God calls us all to exude love in all we do by looking out for each other and by taking care of each other. There is no get-out clause to say, I am not a Christian. When huge things happen in the world, floods and earthquakes and wars, you see ordinary people mobilized to send donations vital for survival. But on an everyday basis, you can see people like Eileen volunteering to do good in their local community also. Every day, my friends, there are circumstances that require love in action. Someone we know has been bereaved. Someone we know has received the sad news of an accident. Or they've been told that their cancer has come back. Or that they've lost their job. Or maybe they didn't get into the college that they wanted to. Will you respond with an act of kindness, a listening ear, a shoulder to cry on? It could make a huge difference in that person's life. When we're filled with God's Spirit, we feel empathy for people who are hurting. Caring for one another is what I know Eileen would say, is what makes us faithful and faith-filled. And it's what makes life worth living. Paul exhorts, let us not become weary in doing good. For at the proper time, we will reap a harvest if we don't give up. Did you note the year of Eileen's birth, my friends? Did you do the math? She never gave up. So, many of us have a way to reach that age. We should never give up. So therefore, as we have opportunity, Paul says, let us do good to all people. To all people. That's the message Eileen wanted you to hear today, my friends, that you put the law of Christ's love in your hearts. As a lifelong committed Christian, Eileen also would want you to hear Paul's reminder to the Galatians that the heart of the gospel and our world is the cross of Christ crucified for us, and not our good works. My mother always taught me that pride comes before a fall. Our pride must not be in what we do, or how we compare our actions to others. But in all things, we should never boast of anything except the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Amen. Just before we move on to our next part of the service, I wanted to say just something else, and I meant to do it beforehand, so I'm walking forward to say it, because I know if Eileen could see me, her pride would know no bounds, not because of me, and I know she was proud of me, but because of what I'm wearing. This, we call it a cope, and my mitre, my bishop's mitre, was given to me last August in Barbados by Bishop Wilfred Wood. And it is the first time I am wearing it since it was given to me. And I wear it in remembrance of Eileen and her service to Croydon's people, to our country, Barbados, and to Christ, our Lord, Savior, and Redeemer.
Amen.
Shall we pray together? When I say the words, Lord, in your mercy, you are welcome to respond with the phrase, hear our prayer. God of mercy and Lord of life, you have made us in your image to reflect your truth and your light. We give you thanks for Eileen, for the grace and mercy she received from you, for all that was good in her life, and for the special memories that we treasure today. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord Jesus, you promised eternal life to those who believe. Remember for good this your servant, Eileen, as we also remember her. Bring all who rest in Christ into the fullness of your kingdom, where sins have been forgiven and death is no more. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, your mighty power brings joy out of grief and life out of death. Look in mercy today, especially upon Newton and all of Eileen's family who mourn, on all friends and colleagues who mourn her. Give them patient faith in times of darkness. Strengthen them with the knowledge of your love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, you are tender towards your children, and your mercy is over all your works. Heal the memories of hurt and failure. Give us the wisdom and grace to use aright the time that is left to us here on earth, to turn to Christ and to follow in his steps in the way that leads to everlasting life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of mercy, entrusting into your hands all that you have made and rejoicing in our communion with all your faithful people, we make our prayers through Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Amen.
So let us pray with confidence as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. We're now coming to the commendation. So if church would please stand. It's the hymn first. I missed it. When peace like a river, please stand.
Thank you.
just before the commendation to remain standing, I wanted to give thanks to Reverend Amanda. I think you can all hear how unwell she is at the moment. The reader, Regina, was not able to be with us, yes. And she's had to go to work. The person who was to stand in for her contacted her at 1:30 this morning to say she couldn't take her place at work for her. And when I came to, after Newton told me of Eileen's death, and I came to church that morning, Amanda was in tears, and Regina didn't know what to do with herself. And she said, you know, to me, she felt she'd lost a huge part of her life, like a grandmother to her, someone who had supported her in her ministry. And for the fact that she's not here is just a tremendous sadness. And as I say, Reverend Amanda is unwell. And so I just want to commend this church and the ministry here for the way in which the whole church family has been the family, Eileen's family here. And I know that her loss is felt by every single one of you also. So I wanted to make sure that you were also commended in what you have done to support her going and froing and toing and being and everything else that has made her life full. This church played a huge part in bringing that fullness to her life. So thank you all here also. So now let us commend Eileen to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. God, our Creator and Redeemer, by your power, Christ conquered death and entered into glory. And claiming his promises, we entrust Eileen to your mercy. In the name of Jesus, our Lord, who died and is alive and reigns with you now and forever. Amen. And the blessing of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be upon you all and remain with you this day and always. Amen. Now we are going to sing our closing hymn, We Will Gather at the River.
Gather at the river.